30,000 emails that are missing.
That is Canada Trump publicly asking the Russians to get his opponent Hillary Clinton's emails. And the Russians tried to do exactly that. From the 29-page indictment, quote, on or about July 27, 2016, the conspirators attempted after hours to spearfish for first-time email accounts at a domain hosted by a third-party provider and used by Clinton's personal office. Hat tip, by the way, to my colleague Jake Tapper, who points out the Russians apparently took Trump seriously and literally. And we're learning tonight, the U.S. intelligence caught some of the very same Russians named in today's indictments, congratulating each other and celebrating the success of their operation during the campaign. In the wake of all of this, Senator John McCain saying, quote, if President Trump is not prepared to hold Putin accountable, the summit in Helsinki should not move forward. Well, the White House insisting the summit with Putin will go ahead as planned. This is a crucial moment. Will this president call Putin to account and make him answer for his crimes? Will he defend American democracy? That's what a strong leader does. But if President Trump fails to condemn Putin's hacking, a deliberate, premeditated attack on our democracy in the strongest possible terms, you've got to ask yourself, why? Let's bring in now CNN's chief political correspondent, Dana Bash, our chief political analyst, Gloria Borger, crime and justice reporter, Shimon Prokopez, and national security analyst, Matthew Rosenberg. Good evening. I can't believe I'm asking, will the president of the United States defend the American democracy? What strange times we are living in right now. Shimon, you first. So break down, because you have the investigation here, break down what these indictments of these 12 Russian military officers lay out, because of the mountain of evidence. It is really extraordinary.
No, it certainly is, Don. There's quite a lot of evidence in this indictment, and the people that this indictment has targeted are not just, you know, just some folks in Russia. These are senior-level military intelligence officials. You have a commander, a major, a lieutenant colonel, sort of running this hacking operation on behalf of the Russian government. And the indictment lists just about how they went about it. The hacking of the DNC, the hacking of the DCCC, and then, of course, the spearfishing of people attached to the Hillary Clinton campaign and its chairman, John Podesta. And when then the indictment talks about how they went about distributing some of the emails that they were able to obtain, the information that they were able to obtain, creating two personas, Guccifer 2.0, and then, of course, DC leaks, where which they used to distribute some of the material. And then also, though not named in the indictment, WikiLeaks was used as well, according to the indictment. And really, the other thing here, Don, in the indictment, they talk about how a member of the Trump campaign was in contact with Guccifer 2.0. And now we know, based on some of our reporting, and then even Roger Stone's own statements tonight, that he is likely the person who is in touch with Guccifer for 2.0, about some of the material that the Russian intelligence was able to obtain through these hacks. And then lastly, Don, I think another important point here is that according to this indictment, the Russian intelligence, this GRU unit, hacked the website of a state election board where they obtained some information from 500,000 voters. That's driver's license information, addresses, social security numbers. Certainly a concern that now all this information is in the hands of the Russians, Don.
It's, as you were going through that, Shimon, I mean, it's amazing, because it's, mm-hmm. it's really complicated, Dana, and it's a lot. And not only complicated, it's extremely serious, and you have to wonder, it's why the president may not be taking it seriously, still calling it a witch hunt, even after Rosenstein, you know, briefed him. We all remember that clip of Donald Trump from July 27th, 2016, mm-hmm. Russia, if you're listening, right? And what we learn in this indictment is Russians were listening, because on the exact same day, they started these spearfishing attacks on the Clinton campaign. It's remarkable.
It is remarkable. The exact day that you played the clip, you showed the quote from the indictment, and they were... It was public, so you certainly can make the argument that it wasn't sort of privately colluding, but they were paying attention, the Russians, in a big way. And just to kind of answer the fundamental question that you're asking about why the president is still calling it a witch hunt, why he called it that more than one time during this trip he is on, even though Rod Rosenstein, his own deputy attorney general, announced today that he briefed the president several days ago about this. And the answer is, and it bears repeating, we've said it many times over the past year and a half, the president when he hears Russia and he hears meddling, he hears my presidency is illegitimate. That's what the accusation is on me.
Yeah.
And it still is, even to this day, even with the incredible detail that we see in this indictment about the lengths to which these Russian intelligence officials, as Shimon said, high-ranking officials, went to build this elaborate, highly technical scheme, very expensive scheme, in order to meddle in and disrupt an American election.
Yeah. Gloria, you can hear me, right? And you're not having trouble with your earpiece? Okay, good. Okay, because you're nodding your head there. The response in the White House, I mean, you would think, like, there was great forensics. Well, I want to thank our Justice Department and our investigators. They're top-notch. But this is the response from the White House today. It says, today's charges include no allegations of knowing involvement of anyone on the campaign and no allegations that the alleged hacking affected the election results. This is consistent with what we have been saying all along. Why do they even need to say that? Like, why didn't they say Russia attacked, hacked our election, they will pay, they need to stop? What's going on here?
They declared war on the United States of America. This will not stand, as one former president said. This will not stand. Instead, what we got was an incredibly narcissistic statement from the White House, which said, this is about me, as Dana was saying, this is about the legitimacy of the Trump presidency.
Is he derelict in his duties by responding this way?
Look, I think when you're president of the United States, it's incumbent upon you to talk to the American people about the risk the democracy is at as a result of this Russian hacking. Mm-hmm. I mean, presidents are supposed to rise above.
Right.
And they're supposed to tell the American people the truth and tell the American people what is at stake here. And, you know, it was very interesting to me today, Don, because I was listening to Rod Rosenstein very carefully. Mm-hmm. And he went a little bit beyond, you know, just talking about the indictment, et cetera, and said it in effect that politics should not get in the way here. And we should not judge this indictment by who was victimized, mm-hmm. i.e. Hillary Clinton and the Hillary Clinton campaign. And I think that is, you know, that is the way Donald Trump judges it, which is that Hillary Clinton was the victim here. He was the beneficiary. If it had been reversed, he'd be screaming about the Russians.
Yeah.
But it isn't.
Yeah.
And so this is the way he sees it. And I think Rosenstein was sending a very strong signal, like, stop this.
Yeah. Not just with what he said, but with doing it today, right?
Exactly.
Doing it today on the eve of this summit. Yeah. That's no accident.
Very astute assessment there, Gloria. Matthew, let me bring you in because, you know, I spoke to Dana about just how, you know, I was listening to Shimon, and it's a lot to take in if you're thinking, we cover it every single day. And for the average person at home, they're like, Guccifer and do 2.0 and, you know, all of these folks who are involved is Roger Stone and what have you. And you have to, like, put all these names together and systems and spearfishing and what have you. But the remarkable amount of detail, Mueller even knows how they paid for it with Bitcoin. What did we learn about the level of detail in this indictment?
I mean, the Bitcoin stuff's remarkable. Look, espionage is a cash business. You got to pay for it somehow, some way. The Bitcoin allows kind of one to kind of remotely pay for something anonymously. This is also a situation they were able to figure out who made what payments through the kind of Bitcoin register, which might, you know, if you're a future criminal or spy, maybe you'll be a little more cautious about which cryptocurrency you use.
This is a new world we're living in, by the way. I mean,
it really is.
Bitcoin, right?
I think overall, though, you know, the level of detail here kind of builds on a narrative that we've known the broad outlines of since this January 2017, when the intelligence kind of agencies released their assessment. And what they said back then was that Russia, during the campaign, had developed developed a clear preference for Mr. Trump. And that's continued here. And that's, when you look at those White House kind of statements and denials, Trump and his supporters said it about the assessment, and they said it again today, saying, well, nobody said any votes were changed. And, you know, that's kind of it's a dodge in a lot of ways.
But he did say that wasn't their role as well.
That wasn't their role. The intelligence assessment said that today. That wasn't the role of the investigators here. We have no idea if votes were changed or not. And that's another piece to look at in today's indictment is the hacking of state voting machines, state election systems, not voting machines, I misspoke there. You know, that's
election
a subject
rolls, yeah.
that remains kind of really deeply shrouded in mystery because there haven't been any kind of complete investigations of any of the states. So we know a little bit here and there, but we actually don't know what went on in a number of states where electoral rolls and there were problems with voting registrations. We simply do not know if any of that was a result of hacking or not, and we still don't know.
It makes one wonder if the old-fashioned way where you go in and you punch a ticket and everything is on paper instead of this whole electronic way, which one is better? You don't listen, anytime you're talking about Bitcoin and cryptocurrency, you're over my head. Rod Rosenstein briefed President Trump earlier this week on the indictments against 12 Russian intelligence officers for election interference. Yet, at his news conference with Britain's prime minister before the charges were announced, the president once again slammed the Mueller investigation as a rigged witch hunt. His words. Back with me now, Dana Bash, Gloria Borger, Shimon Prokopez, and Matthew Rosenberg. Shimon, I'm going to start with you this time. You have details about how intelligence captured some of the defendants congratulating each other. What can you tell us?
Yeah, Don, this is pretty extraordinary. I mean, this just gives us the indications that the U.S. government, the FBI, and certainly intelligence folks were all over this group once they determined what they were up to and what they were doing. And they were able to collect essentially intelligence that showed how this group, these Russians, some of which are named in this indictment, were celebrating the success of their operation, that is the hacking operation, the way they got into the DNC, the Hillary Clinton campaign. They were celebrating. And then also after Trump's victory, there was intelligence that indicated this group, some of the people named here, were celebrating his win. And all of this sort of has given the intelligence community and the FBI that feeling that these guys were behind some of this operation, the hacking, sort of the entrance into the DNC and the contact. With the Guccifer 2.0, because what they found was sort of like, why would these guys be celebrating? Why would these guys be so happy about some of this success? And they used some of that to form their opinion and certainly in getting evidence and bringing this indictment.
Dana Bash, another thing that we're learning in this indictment is a congressional candidate requesting stolen documents. So I just want to read some of this. It says, on or about August 15, 2016, the conspirators posing as Guccifer 2.0 received a request for stolen documents from a candidate for the U.S. Congress. The conspirators responded using the Guccifer 2.0 persona and sent the candidate stolen documents related to the candidate's opponent. Does that have a whiff of collusion?
Yeah, I think it's more than a whiff. I think that the stench is pretty thick. But we don't know who we're talking about here. It says U.S. candidate. It's unclear if that candidate won. Unclear what party that candidate is from, and certainly we and others are digging to find out. And I'm glad you brought it up because there's so much information in here, just in terms of, like Shimon was talking about, all of the Russian attempts, successful attempts, to kind of, you know, sow chaos in this election on a presidential level. The fact that there was a candidate for the United States Congress who, according to the way the indictment reads, was proactive in reaching out to this, what turned out to be this Russian intelligence officer, not the other way around. The thing I just want to quickly say about this is, talking about Congress in particular, it's not just about 2016. I mean, we're looking at 2016 now, but talk to Republican and Democratic operatives and members of Congress, as I did today. It's happening now.
Right.
There's evidence that it is happening now, that in a way that could affect and probably will affect this November's election. And the concern among Republicans on Capitol Hill is that what's their ultimate goal in Russia? Mm-hmm. To keep things churning and to keep things chaotic. Mm-hmm. So how do you do that? You help along the Democrats to beat the Republicans in the House. Mm-hmm. If you have a split government, it's inherently more chaotic. And that is something that, by ignoring what happened in the past, you're not able to deal what's happening with Russia, what they're doing in the present.
Gloria, you know, I heard someone commented on another network trying to downplay what Rod Rosenstein announced today, saying, "Oh well, the Russians have been doing this forever; they've been interfering in our elections." That may be so, but to this degree, and with this sort of technology, and looking at the means and the ways that they're doing it, this is unprecedented, and this is huge and should be taken seriously. We shouldn't try to downplay this.
No, of course not. I mean, look, what you're just saying is, in fact, what the president has said to some of his friends whom I've spoken with. You know, he has dismissed this as saying, look, we spy on them, they spy on us. This goes on all the time. And what he doesn't want to do is admit to any way, shape or form that his election might be delegitimized. And, you know, this today says they were pushing on an open door here, and they got a lot of response. I mean, the detail in this indictment to me is stunning, and maybe there's a lot of detail in this indictment because they know that these guys are never going to be brought to trial unless the president in some way gets them extradited, which he won't, or if they go somewhere where we can get them, which they won't. So, you know, the level of detail here should scare anybody of any party about any election because they're invading our democracy. And it's nefarious. And I don't see how any Republican or any Democrat can not pay attention to this and dismiss it as business as usual, because it is not business as usual. It's beyond that, way beyond that.
I wonder, Matthew, what Republicans, and I'm talking about the lawmakers in Washington, what they're so afraid of when it comes to this, meaning why won't they push back hard on the president to admit that Russia influenced, hacked, tried to sabotage the election and is still doing it? But it's to this point, Politico is reporting that House conservatives are preparing a new push to oust Rod Rosenstein. The House Freedom Caucus, supposedly Chairman Mark Meadows, had the impeachment document on the floor of the House when Rosenstein spoke to the press. What do you think this could mean for the Mueller investigation at large, and what are they so afraid of?
I mean, I think there's a gamut here within that party. On, you know, one side, you've got people like Richard Burr, the senator who is leading the Senate investigation into Russian interference, who has pushed back on things that have come out of the White House and is certainly leading what looks to be so far a credible investigation. Then on the other far end of the spectrum, you get some of the House Republicans, like Devin Nunes, who ran the House investigation they shut down and has offered up some, you know, bizarre conspiracy theories at times, and people like Meadows. I mean, I think there are some people in the House who do genuinely believe that this is a witch hunt. You know, there are elements in the Republican Party that do see overlap.
I just
one
person sentence. We're talking about Van der Swan, guilty pleas from five people: George Papadopoulos, yeah, Michael Flynn, Rick Gates, Richard Panetto, and Alex Van der Swan. At least 35 defendants, 32 individuals and companies, and at least 191 charges. Let Matthew finish, and I'll let you
sure
go, Dana.
Yeah. Sure.
I mean, look, I'm certainly not don't see a witch hunt here. But I think you do have some people.
Paul should be on alert. Each of these people travel in Europe with their families. Their kids go to school overseas. These are people who have money hidden.
All right,
no,
I hear you about the practicalities, but what does he need to say? Because we've seen him be real tough with the NATO allies. We've seen him be real tough with Theresa May, who's also a NATO ally, obviously. But she just laid out the red carpet. He does an interview with the Sun and trashes her. How tough does he need to be with Vladimir Putin?
I think this being the first real, bilateral meeting, I think, you know, Russia's economy is the size of New York State. You know, I think the president needs to look at Vladimir Putin and tell him, listen, you know, we disassembled the USSR. We could do the same thing with the Russian Federation. I mean, I know the Russian Federation wants to play on par with the G7. I don't think they should have been in the G7. They shouldn't have made it the G8 to begin with until they joined the family of man. But the fact of the matter is, I think these indictments are weak. I think that it's litigation instead of a tit for tat. I think our military hackers should be working overtime right now to do the exact thing back.
Part of the reason
they're
not
stop this
is because the president doesn't want that. I mean, part of the reason that we need this probe is because the president wasn't a believer about U.S. meddling, Russian meddling in the U.S. election, and did certain acts to try to stop the investigation. Not that they were illegal, not that they were nefarious, but he didn't like it. And that's part of the reason we are where we are right now. And the only
one of the reasons we are
Go ahead.
One of the reasons we are where we are right now, and I said this in July of 2016, the hacks or whatever they are, server or no server, these attacks on our nation were provocations from the Kremlin, and something needed to be done about it in 2016.
From Trump, too. Trump gave a rally on July 27th.
But I mean, something needed to be done about this in 2015, Chris.
Well, hold on a second.
2016.
Yeah, no, look. No question, the Obama administration has stink on it. We get what their mentality was about feeling they were in a catch-22. Whatever, they should have done more. They didn't. Shame on them. Fair point. However, we know a hell of a lot more now than we did then. And President Trump, at a rally on July 27, 2016, said in full-throated fashion, Russia, find the Hillary emails. And now we know in this indictment, after hours that same damn night, they did exactly that. They started spearfishing. So this is a situation he has to own, and it raises the question, Mike, why doesn't he? Why is it when it comes to Putin, he has kid gloves on his hands? The guy pointed missiles at his house. Do you remember that video? I had them pull it. He pointed missiles. This is from Putin, showing the range of their missiles and how far they could go. And you know where they wind up coming down? Forget about the mountains.
Yeah.
Florida. Right in the region of where Mar-a-Lago is. And you know what Trump said? Crickets.
Kind of shrugged it off. You know,
not a damn thing. There are the missiles coming down.
And Chris, you know, I lived there. I lived there for a long time. I was there for 7 years. I understand Russia fairly well. I think each one of our presidents, like I said, have come in with kind of Pollyanna looks on their faces, and they learned, each one of them, that they can't trust Vladimir Putin. I think we're at a point now, and the chapter and verse in these indictments, I think they're weak. I think it's feckless. I think we should be attacking back with our military capacity on the Internet. I think we should be draining Chairman Karabov of the GRU's bank accounts right now, today. But, you know, having said that, these indictments are a pretty clear description of facts and truths that need to inform the president's meeting with Vladimir Putin.
Well, I think hopefully
it's turned a light on. I think it's turned a light on, and I hope the president takes a good look at it.
Well, look, he's had every reason to know the truth for a long time. Nobody has access to better information on this than he does. But this is the moment he wanted, Michael. I'll be there in Helsinki. He's going to meet face to face with Putin. This is his chance to prove that anybody who says that he's soft on Putin is wrong. We'll see what he does. I'll talk to you after it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chris.
All right. So, as I said earlier, the president knew these indictments were coming. How do we know? Because Rosenstein said it today, that he had informed the White House earlier in the week. So he still went out after knowing about this and told the world that he hopes to make friends with Putin. Why would he say that? My next guest says because of that, he wants to cancel Monday's meeting. Senator Richard Blumenthal is on primetime next. Good to see you, sir.
For somebody to
cancel the meeting.
Well, you answered that question, I think, in one of your very first sentences on this show when you said Vladimir Putin ordered this attack on our democracy. Your word, ordered. And the fact of the matter is that it was an act of war. Now, for Donald Trump to meet with this enemy of the United States, he's no friend, he's an adversary and an enemy, and he means us nothing good. It elevates him and legitimizes that attack. What Trump has to do now is hit back and hit back hard and make the Russians pay a price. And there is a tremendous danger of miscalculation. What Donald Trump ought to be doing instead of meeting with Vladimir Putin is ordering heightened sanctions, exposing the corruption within the Russian regime for the Russian people to see, and freezing assets and disclosing them here in the United States, belonging to those oligarchs and top Russian officials. There are steps we can take.
Well, look, the indictment does just that, right? I mean, this is what you know, you guys in the law used to call, on the prosecution side, name and shame, right? The practicality of getting these guys is not the highest degree, but you put the names out there, you show what happened. We saw it in Pittsburgh when they named those Chinese hackers. They didn't have a great chance of getting them, but they put the names out there, let it be known what the Chinese state was doing. Why isn't the meeting a win-win from your perspective, that if the president goes and he speaks truth to power the way he says he will, then you get that message sent to Putin in a way that maybe we've never heard it before? And if he doesn't, if he falls short, if he uses those kid gloves that he keeps using where Putin is involved, you win anyway, because he becomes exposed once and for all for not standing up to this man.
There is so much more at stake here, Chris, than just the politics of the moment. We are under attack, not only in the past, but it is continuing. That's the collective wisdom. It's unanimous among the intelligence community. They've said it publicly, so I'm not giving away any classified information as a member of the Armed Services Committee. The attack is continuing, and now is the time to make the Russians pay a price. No more business as usual, no more bromance. The dangers of both courses, his failing to stand up to them and his continuing this kind of infatuated bromance, are really perilous. And to allow him to go into that meeting alone is national security negligence on the part of his advisors and his top staff.
Let me ask you something. How significant is it to you that no Americans were named in this indictment today? I know it doesn't mean that there will be no more indictments. I get that. But they kind of went to great lengths here to not name anybody else while suggesting that there are people known and unknown, Organization One, which we all know is WikiLeaks, Company One, which we know is CrowdStrike. You know, they went to lengths. A person who was talking to Trump's senior staff, who everybody was going to find out was Roger Stone. He played around with it early on, but he even owned it tonight on the show. Why don't you think any Americans are named if they were involved?
That's really a great question, Chris. And quite honestly, nobody but Robert Mueller and his staff knows the real answer to it. But I'll give you my hunch about it. Number one, in order to name people in this indictment, just like every single sentence and allegation in this complaint, there has to be proof beyond a reasonable doubt. The standard is not, gee, this is an interesting fact, or
well, that's to convict them. As you know, look, you're a much better lawyer than I ever was. But, you know, just to put it in the indictment, that's not the standard. They could have indicted somebody.
No, Chris, it is the standard, because for a prosecutor, and I was one, a United States attorney, indictment means you need to be able to go to a jury and prove, indictment means you need to be able to go to a jury and prove those charges beyond a reasonable doubt.
Right,
you cannot put yourself in the position of making allegations that cannot be proved. But here's another point. This investigation is continuing, and those Americans who were not named but clearly were involved, there is more than Roger Stone, there are allusions to other Americans, are put on notice, and the Russians and everybody involved in this investigation is put on notice that there is more to come. And I think that is a very powerful message. He may not have the evidence now to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, but remember, when George Papadopoulos was finally not only indicted but actually convicted, it was months after he actually entered his plea of guilty. So Robert Mueller is playing by his own strategy and playbook.
But are you a little worried about hanging your hat on the potential that Americans are going to be named for colluding with Russia? And I know colluding is an illegal term, but in part of a conspiracy with Russia to meddle in the election. Because, you know, it's been set up as a standard for a lot of people. It never has been for me. I've always been fighting this conflation fight. Even today, the White House said, here's our takeaway from the indictments. No allegations that any American did anything. No allegations of any staffer. No allegations that the president did anything. You know, this is conflation. This indictment is part of the mainline mandate for the special counsel, which is to find out who did what for Russia. And that's why they named these dozen people. But there's been this conflation. And in fairness, a lot of Democrats are part of this, saying there's going to be collusion. What if there isn't?
The point here is really to better protect our nation. Our national security is at stake because the Russians are continuing to attack us. Robert Mueller is performing a profoundly important public service by following the facts and the law where they lead. And it should be above politics. The spectacle yesterday of the haranguing and harassing a witness before a congressional committee is the opposite of the approach that Robert Mueller is taking. No public statements, just the facts and the law. So we may speculate about conflation and collusion and conspiracy, but what will be revealed at the end is a factual record of the Russian attack on this country, deliberate, direct, destructive, right, ordered by Vladimir Putin, an act of war.
Thank you, Senator Richard Blumenthal. Thank you for being on the show, especially on a Friday night. Appreciate it, sir.
Thank you.
Don Lemon has no choice on a Friday night but to be on CNN, although he finds a way out of it sometimes. No. His show's coming up in a few minutes. You know, it's very
paying
interesting.
Paying a mortgage, Chris.
You know. I know you are, at least one. The idea of what this means, what we saw today in this indictment, is a really interesting one because it does come on the eve. It's very interesting. I haven't had anybody from the right tonight bring up that the timing was wrongful. Yeah. I thought for sure that was going to be a mainline argument, that this shows Mueller's dirty because he brought it out right before we meet with Putin. Yeah. And, you know, there's some suggestion that the president wanted this to come out. And even though he knew about it, Don, he said, this meeting's going to be easy with Putin.
Well, he briefed him before he left, right?
Right. But that's some definition of easy. You've got this indictment and all of this heavy weight on you with real facts about what these guys did. And now you're going to the man who may have ordered it all.
Yeah. And here's the thing. Here's what we're doing. Everyone's been talking about how the president is responding to this. You talked about how Republicans and the timing. You questioned all of that. We know what the Kremlin said, basically using the same words as the White House. This is a witch hunt. Mm-hmm. This is fake news and on and on and on. But I have some Russian experts on who are going to tell me how will Vladimir Putin and how is he reacting to this to have 12 of his military intelligence officers indicted when the president is coming over. That's what we're going to break down tonight and what this means for the meeting of the titans. And you will be there, right? You're gone? Yeah.
I'll bring you back.
So you'll be covering that, and we'll have those
herring
on tonight.
See you later.
Yeah, I like pickle herring, so bring me some back.
He doesn't like pickle. I'll see you later. Something else quite remarkable happened today. It is a truth check that may end all speculation. Not the best things about her leadership. So when asked about this at a presser with the prime minister today, instead of owning his words, he went to his signature move.
Fortunately, we tend to record stories now, so we have it for your enjoyment if you'd like it, but we record when we deal with reporters. It's called fake news.
Remember that? He's talking about The Sun, which is run by his friend Rupert Murdoch. Remember, no one's safe when they're unflattering to Trump. Now, he also said in the piece, you know, a poll just came out that I'm the most popular person in the history of the Republican Party. 92% beating Lincoln. I beat our honest Abe. They didn't have polling when Abe Lincoln was president, and most GOPers were equal or better to Trump at this point in their presidency. And he exaggerated his own polling with GOPers by 4 points. So that's all truth, abuse, false, fake. But there's a bigger challenge here. Either Trump was taken out of context, as he suggests, or, and there were a lot of nice things said that were hidden or not. And here's the good part. Here's the challenge. We can know the answer. The Sun says they have tapes. They put out about 8 minutes or so of a roughly 30-minute interview. We can't find the rest, but they say they have them. They must be like the Sun and shine the light on everything said. And if they can't, Trump said, you just heard him, that he has tapes too. He told reporters, you can get it from Sarah, Sarah Sanders, right? He has suggested this before, that they have tapes and not produce them. We have been told that the traveling pool did ask for that audio more than 8 hours ago. No sign yet that the White House is going to give them up. So, it's either a big deal or it isn't. Now, I know people are going to say, everyone lies in politics. No, the truth matters, especially now. And someone lying a lot doesn't make their lying less of a lie. We should not apply a different standard to our president than we do to our kids. Can you imagine letting your 8-year-old get away with lying about doing her homework? I have one at home. This is a very factual scenario. No, we wouldn't do it. But it's okay when a president calls out the media and attacks any who try to call him out on a world stage? No, it isn't. Produce the tape, son, please. If not, Sarah, get after it, all right? Make the truth known. This is a put up or shut up moment. All right, that's all I have. We're going to be live from Helsinki Monday night for President Trump's big meeting with Vladimir Putin. CNN Tonight with Don Lemon starts right now.
What a week. Remember what we started with on Monday? Supreme Court.
Then
the kids. Yeah, the Supreme Court. And then the kids were supposed to be reunited under five. And what a week. And then we have him on his trip overseas. Now he's meeting with Vladimir Putin, with Theresa May. I mean, my goodness.
Plenty of things to cover.
Plenty of things. And now the indictments. So lots to cover.
Happy Friday night.
Yeah. See you soon. This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. On the brink of the president's face-to-face meeting with Vladimir Putin, a huge development in the Mueller investigation to tell you about. The Justice Department today announcing indictments against a dozen Russians and not just some shadowy hackers, all of them intelligence officers in Vladimir Putin's military, accusing them of engaging in a sustained effort to hack Democrats' emails and computer networks during the 2016 campaign. The indictment announced by Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein at almost exactly the moment that President Trump met Queen Elizabeth at Windsor Castle. And make no mistake, Robert Mueller was very much aware that the president's next meeting is his planned summit with Vladimir Putin himself in just 3 days, a meeting behind closed doors with only interpreters present. Well, Rod Rosenstein said today he briefed the president about the allegations earlier this week. But I want you to listen to what President Trump said just this morning, again, calling the investigation a witch hunt when he knew what Mueller had.
I think that we're being hurt very badly by the, I would call it the witch hunt. I would call it the rigged witch hunt that really hurts our country and it really hurts our relationship with Russia. I think that we would have a chance to have a very good relationship with Russia and a very good chance, a very good relationship with President Putin.
A sustained effort to undermine the credibility of the Russian investigation. That's not the only example of Donald Trump's own words coming back to haunt him. Listen to what he said. This is July 27th of 2016, just months before Election Day.
Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000. 000-